And we're now joined by Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, a co-author of the Anti-Hazing Act of 2018. Senator Gatchalian, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen. Good morning to our televiewers.
All right, is a review of the law needed?
Well, Karen, first of all, I want to extend my condolences to the Salilig family, and I am one with them in seeking for justice. On the law itself, no? The law is quite new, relatively new. It's 2018, and it's an offshoot of what happened to Acho Castillo in 2017. Unfortunately, I saw on television yesterday, the case is still being heard right now. So it's important to implement the law. It's important to fully exercise all the penal provisions in the law. The law is quite comprehensive. If you are caught planning, if you are at the hazing venue, if you are caught hazing, even those who obstruct justice, they will be put in jail according to the law. So it's important to fully implement the law to precisely what you were saying earlier, to cut the culture of violence among fraternities.
Now, Senator, the law is quite clear and the penalties are harsh.
Yes.
And we have another death. So let's go specific to how this can be implemented today. Is it the university? Or frankly speaking, should fraternities themselves? I don't know. Is it have seminars on the law, threaten students that if they conduct hazing, this can happen to them? Ano bang dapat gawin? Kasi at the end of the day, estudyante din ang makukulong. So they've ruined their lives too with that one act.
Unfortunately, Karen, even after the law was enacted in 2018, there were 10 reported hazing cases to the media and also to the police. And one of the most recent reported cases was last March of 2022, also by the Tau Gamma Phi fraternity. So this fraternity, Tau Gamma Phi, seems to be quite notorious when it comes to fraternities. So, and one of the reasons why this is still happening, no, 10 cases after the law, is because we're not putting criminals in jail. No, they still roam around. They still hide within our justice system, and some of them are still at large. So it's important to apprehend all of these criminals, and number two, put them behind bars because the law is very strict. Number two, if there's one important, if there's one amendment that I will propose, is to put more responsibilities on the groups.
Yeah.
I'm not isolating fraternities and sororities, so groups in general, you know, who practice initiation. In the law, there are responsibilities for barangays, there's responsibilities for schools, but there's no responsibilities for these groups. Mm-hmm. So if there's one amendment that I will be proposing is to put heavy burden on the groups to educate, to cut the culture of violence within the ranks.
All right. That's very interesting because, you know, in other cultures, if you did something repeatedly that was frowned upon, you would be a pariah of some sort. But here, when it's done under the fraternity's umbrella, for example, it's only the perpetrators who were caught, but the organization itself is not answerable at all. In other words, they're still welcome everywhere. There's no punishment in terms of job application. There's no disbanding of an organization in that school. Yun ang tanong eh. Diba? Parang, shouldn't there be, Senator, more stakeholder accountability within a fraternity and a sorority? Kumbaga, uy, kung kayo, nahuli kayo mag-hazing, kahit wala ako doon, damay ako. Dapat ganun. Or damay ang buong organisasyon natin.
Karen, you're absolutely correct. And this is my challenge to all fraternities, Tau Gamma Phi and the other fraternities, for their leadership to come out and denounce hazing. Mm-hmm. Call for to end hazing is not so clear among the leadership of the different fraternities. And this is the right time. This is the time, actually, to for the leadership of all fraternities and sororities, for this matter, to come out and denounce all forms of violence within the ranks of fraternities. Because the fraternities, it's their reputation is on the line. Their reputation is being damaged by all of this. And we don't, we personally, no, I don't want to curtail the freedom of our students and people to join groups. However, those groups who are always embroiled in violence, mm-hmm. The leadership should come out and denounce it clearly, because that's the starting point. And that's also one of the things that I'm looking at, including in if ever we amend the law, is to make it more pronounced that groups should come up with activities, mm-hmm. with statements, to and also concrete steps, you know, to end violence within the ranks.
Mm-mm. Okay, Senator, reading the anti-hazing law, it says here that there has to be an application in the barangay. And I wanted to ask you that, because it says at least two barangay or municipal or city officials must be present during the initiation rites. But doesn't this go against the very essence of an initiation rite? Because students would want it to be clandestine.
Correct, correct. The a lot of these fraternities operate under the concept of secrecy. No, a lot of them they recruit in secrecy. They do initiations in secrecy, and that's the come on of a lot of these fraternities and sororities, that they are allowed to recruit, but not openly. No. And that provision there is to make them accountable, you know, when they do initiation rites. But I think what is more important here, Karen, is for the fraternities to come up with activities to prevent violence, mm-hmm. because this is, like you said, no, this is culture changing.
Yeah,
and it's important for the organizations to be proactive. The law is silent on that, because the law expects them that, because of all of these harsh penalties, that they will do their part. But unfortunately, I'm not seeing a proactive movement from the fraternities insofar as curbing violence within their groups.
Yeah, good point. So it's a movement. What you'd want to see is a reverse, that if hazing is conducted, the fraternities will frown upon the activity itself, because it seems that it is part of an existing culture still. Diba? Parang wag ka lang mahuli, wag ka lang makapatay. Ganon. Pero nandun pa rin. So, Senator, what about the schools? How can they engage better? Because you have thousands of students in a university. So it's very difficult, for example, for Adamson or for any other school to police every single student in the school.
Well, Karen, I always believe that the schools know what's happening within their campus, mm-hmm. and within their barangay or community. And again, it's all proactiveness, no? The school should also be proactive in terms of educating students, in terms of monitoring this type of activities in their schools. Like, for example, in Valenzuela, we're very, very conscious about groups, different groups operating in our schools, in our universities, no? And we have a form of intelligence gathering or information gathering to know
so
what's
proactive,
happening.
Proactive,
because we don't want this to happen in Valenzuela. Mm-hmm. In fact, we also engage. In fact, yesterday I was just talking to some of the Tau Gamma members in Valenzuela, and I asked them about these things. No, and if the local groups are proactive, no, for example, in Valenzuela, and they are conscious that this should not happen within the city, they will do everything they can to monitor and to report. And this is my challenge to the Tau Gamma fraternity, to report all of these cases of hazing, to be the partner of the government in terms of erasing the culture of violence, and for the case of Salilig, to report the members who are embroiled, who are connected to this hazing incident. they have to demonstrate that they are helping the government, because mm-hmm. this is the only way to send a strong signal that their group is already denouncing violence in their fraternity.
Good point. So you're asking for the Tau Gamma Phi chapter in Adamson University to also come out and give out all the names of who was involved in the hazing and planning.
They should. I mean, sure,
because
they
have not done that. The one speaking right now is a student who was with Salilig, I believe, in the vehicle.
Karen, I know how they operate there because I'm friends also with the Tau Gamma people here in Valenzuela. And they explained to me the hierarchy of this group. So they know exactly who are the people operating in the different chapters. They might have breakaway groups, admittedly, but they still know the hierarchy. In fact, they have regular oath taking. They have regular selection of members. Mm-hmm. And in Valenzuela, they're very conscious of violence. And I've always remind them that the city should not be embroiled in any of this hazing cases. So in my point of the matter there is, if the members are proactive and the members will be working with the government, it can be prevented. Oh. But obviously, some of the chapters and the leadership itself, no, is not working with government in this particular case. So a first step is to turn over the names of those who are embroiled. Mm-hmm. And those who are, unfortunately, Karen, some of the parents are also accomplices of these criminals. Eh? Mm-hmm. That's why in the law, it's very clear. No, if someone is obstructing an investigation or pursuit of justice, they can be put in jail as well.
Mm-mm. Okay. All right. So you believe there's no need to review the measure, but will you be proposing an amendment, or you just like to throw it on the floor as a matter of discussion?
I think a large part will be implementing the law and prosecuting, putting them behind bars. Those 10 reported cases to the media and to the police, they're still being heard right now. Mm-hmm. Some of the perpetrators are still at large. Just imagine, after enacting the law, the new law in 2018, there are 10 cases reported. We don't even know if the others are not being reported. So in other words, walang natatakot, Karen. Nobody is scared or nobody is worried about the law. And that should be worrisome for us, no? Because we're changing a culture of violence, and the only way to do that is to make them to show the public that we are very serious in putting people behind bars if they're caught doing hazing.
Mm-mm. All right. Now, I want to move on to another topic. In the lower house, moves to change the charter have been gaining ground. In fact, right now, a resolution has been filed for a constitutional convention in the lower house to change the charter. What are your thoughts first on the method and changing the charter today?
Karen, I filed my own version to amend the economic provisions of the Constitution. Okay. And my rationale to that is, I think I talked about this with you one time, is some of these sectors are not attuned to the times right now. For example, education. It's still limited to Filipino ownership and Filipino institution. But the world now is changing. Education is being internationalized, and respected institutions such as Harvard, Stanford, they're looking to operate, opening up their own market and looking to operate in other jurisdictions.
True. You
know? For example, in the Middle East, Harvard and Stanford put up a campus there to lure people from the Middle East. No, my point there is there are provisions in the Constitution that restrict economic activity, and I have filed a bill to do that. Insofar as the Constitutional Convention is concerned, and this is my own personal thought on that, is without any limitation to, let's say, anti-dynasty, the people who will run during the Constitutional Convention are family members of the politicians themselves.
Exactly.
Magiging the same personalities rin, no? So we will not get the true sentiment of the people, but instead we will be getting the true sentiment of the politicians once again. No? Mm-hmm. And that is dangerous because then we will go into the political aspect of the Constitution. And that if you do that, that's a lot of things that we will be opening up.
Mm-mm. So, Senator, instead of a constitutional convention, I'm curious. I know it was unpopular in the beginning. Is a constituent assembly more practical when it comes to just the economic provisions?
Yeah, you're absolutely correct. In fact, I was going to say that. If you are just focusing on just the economic provisions, and we're just talking about a dozen provisions in the Constitution, just limit it to the existing personalities in Congress, no? Mm-hmm. And that is by constitutional assembly, because we're only focusing on just a dozen items. Mm-hmm. And because of that, the existing structure right now, or the existing personalities, can very well handle that. Because right now, we're talking about a lot of economic policies, for example, e-governance, taxation. Those are economic policies and economic legislation, and we're handling it quite well. No, so in other words, if you just limit it to just the economic provisions, constitutional assembly is more practical and faster.
Okay, and then how do you then now address this, considering CONCON is moving in the House, and you have you and your colleagues that are resistant to CONCON? So there's a lot of time wasted, right? Because clearly they're putting their effort on CONCON. It's not going to pass in the Senate. You've all made yourselves clear. You, Senator Robin Padilla, Senator Loren Legarda yesterday, and so many others. So how do you then, I guess, talk among yourselves to say, look, let's just focus on the economic provisions and let's do it this way? Is that possible early on?
Yes, it's important to talk about the goal. What do we want to achieve?
Yeah.
Karen, like in my case, what I want to achieve is to open up the country some more in terms of the economy. And what is the fastest and the most logical way to do that? I don't want to talk about the political provisions, no, extending terms, removing term limits. For me, that's out of my direction. So the first step is to talk, the both houses should talk. What do we want to do? And number two, analyze whether the economic provisions will actually yield to an increase in economic activity. You know? Let's understand that also. And then number three, what is the most practical way? I understand that a CONCON will also need additional budget. I understand that additional 2 or 3 billion to initiate a CONCON. That's a lot of money. No? 2 billion is still 2 billion. An existing.
I don't even think it's only 2 billion.
Or maybe more. No, yeah. That's what I heard from.
It was over 20 something, but we can correct this later.
Yeah, that's what I heard, because they need to apparently print out another ballot. No, to write the names. But nevertheless, the Constitutional Assembly is quite economical. If you limit it to, can we achieve it by doing this? And then number three, what is the most practical way of doing so?
Okay. Another thing here is the fact that President Marcos Jr. says it's not his priority, but yet you have several lawmakers in the lower house already delving into it, and even the political provisions. So ang tanong ko, paano ito if you both have different goals?
Yeah, that's the thing, no, Karen. If the president will not be on board, then everything's futile. No, I think what's important here also is to get the opinion and also the direction from the president, because at the end of the day, it's the president who will implement all of these things. No, so yeah, it's important to get the executive side on board as well. Well, this cannot move by just one house pushing it. No, it's a huge endeavor, and the whole country will be affected. So it's important to get the consent of everyone.
So you believe if the president makes it clear, he says, "I'll only approve the economic provisions." Nakikita niyo, Senator, dun mas may pag-asa.
Definitely, and you can see that the president is really focused on reviving our economy. The trips to abroad is now yielding fruit in terms of concrete investments. The road shows that he and the economic managers have been doing in the last 8 months have been bearing fruit. So the goal, the message that we are getting here, you know, from the president and from the economic managers is we want to revive the economy. We want to grow GDP so we can lower down our debt. And the only way to do that is to get external capital to come in. And that's a good way. That's a good model to grow the country. And I think to support that even more is to amend the economic provisions. So what are the restrictive economic provisions? I mentioned education there. No? So that's one of them. And that's why it's important to get everyone on board moving towards one direction.
Okay. But then I know that. Tell me if this is also where you're going. An amendment of Articles 12, 14, and 16. Do you still just want to add the phrase, unless provided by law? Or it's already different now?
Which article is that? Sorry, is that
okay? What I've read, this is already coming from the lower house. Their amendments are Articles 12, 14, and 16. It's essentially restrictions on foreign investments, those areas. But the proposal in the beginning was just to add unless provided by law.
In general, yeah. Most of my proposal is to give Congress the power to dictate how much foreign capital or foreign ownership do we need for a certain industry or for a certain sector. So it's very dynamic. And for example, if Congress wants to open up completely the education sector to 100% ownership,
yes,
then do so.
Pwede.
Yes. For example, telecom. The Public Services Act now allows 100% ownership of cell phones,
yes,
mobile phones, telecom companies, internet companies, and that's the flexibility that we gave Congress in so far as public services and public services concerned. So the same principle applies to other sectors.
Okay. But what are the other restrictive sectors, considering you just mentioned it? There's already relaxed restrictions during former President Duterte's time on public services and also the Retail Trade Liberalization Act. Kumbaga, yes, you've done this already, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian. So education is one. What about public transport? Would that be a change?
Yep, in the Public Services Act, it's not allowed. No, for example, I know for a fact that Air Asia, the owner of the Malaysian owner of Air Asia, Mr. Fernandez, wants to increase its ownership in Air Asia Philippines, but he was prevented to just 40% because of the limitation. But now, because of the new Public Services Act, he can actually own 100% of airlines here in the Philippines.
Okay. So what about natural resources? This was mentioned to me by one of the congressmen. This is one aspect that they believe it should be relaxed.
Okay. There are two aspects that I am quite conservative about. No? Number one is ownership of land. Number two is ownership of resources. No? That should be limited to Filipinos. However, the development of resources is now allowed to be 60% owned by foreigners. So, for example, if I drill oil and gas through the FTAA, the Financial Technical Agreements, I can actually own a majority of that extraction and I can be compensated using the resources there. But the ownership of the resource itself is still limited to Filipino because we need to also make sure that wealth is cascaded to our continent. Mm-hmm. And it will not be the tendency of that is if you allow ownership of resources itself, that will be taken out of our country and brought to a different jurisdiction. So we need to make sure that it's kept here in our country.
Okay. In terms of modeling, I wanted to ask you, because Congressman Rufus Rodriguez said that in ASEAN, we have the most restrictive constitution and we are the third most restrictive in the world. So that was quite surprising, actually, when I heard it. Should we model from an ASEAN country in terms of certain economic provisions?
I think what is important Karen, is our constitution is responsive to the times. No? For example, I keep on going back to education because that's the thing I studied carefully. Mm-hmm. In the past, no? During the early past, early years, the dimension of education, let's keep it to Filipinos because we don't want to be brainwashed by other cultures or other countries. No? But now things have changed. No? You can actually take your MBA through the internet.
That's true.
You can actually take your PhD through the internet from the US, from the UK, from any other college outside of the Philippines. And that has totally changed. No? And now countries are also looking to set up shop outside of their jurisdiction to increase their market and to increase their revenue. And we should take advantage of what they call internationalization of education. And that's very restricted, no, in our constitution, and that's the thing that one of the things that I'm quite passionate about in opening up.
So at least you're clear, you're not fully against it, but you're only for the economic provisions.
Yes.
I don't have
except
any
for land and resources.
Except for land and resources. Before we go, just a quick one. Where are you now with the Maharlika Investment Fund?
We received an invitation that today will be the start of the technical working group.
Okay.
And we will be requesting from the BSP, from the DOF, more technical data. During the hearing, they gave us some overview, but we requested for more technical data, and we will crunch those technical data because we have to be very prudent. No? For example, BSP's capital will be put in the Maharlika Investment Fund. And we found out that it will take now 17 years for BSP to improve its capital base. 17 years is a long time. No? It's a lot of uncertainty. Yeah. So we need to look at that.
All right. On that note, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, thank you for joining me today. A pleasure to speak with you, sir.
Thank you, Karen.